Escorts Hospital, Amritsar, and the topic is Lipid Management, Facts and Controversies.
So good morning everybody, and thank you Vitul for inviting me here. Vitul is an old friend, and we have studied together, and also we are accident mates. We had a very serious accident together, but both of them saved. Meghna is laughing. So I'm here to speak about lipid management, the facts and the controversies. Now this topic was surrounded by a lot of controversies. Once we received a message on the WhatsApp, the cholesterol is finally officially out from the naughty list. So this is the one message in the WhatsApp which got so viral that all patients, they used to come to you, they'll discuss this message, they'll ask various questions, and even doctors got confused. This message was even being circulated into the doctors' groups that what is it, what is this happening? So is it a fake news or what? So this basically, in 2015, the guidelines came from American Agriculture Department, Food and Agriculture Department. And as we are advancing, we are gaining knowledge. So we came to know that eating high cholesterol diet does not increase blood cholesterol. So that was the message which was conveyed other way around. But it does not say that one should not concern, we should not be concerned about this high cholesterol level. Nor does it declare that there is no difference in the good cholesterol or the bad cholesterol. Nor does it say that high cholesterol does not cause heart disease. And nor does it say that you should stop taking statins. Now, as far as statins are concerned, again, there is one school of thought working that all this LDL hypothesis is a big drama and is all pharma-created scene, and that is why the drugs are selling like anything. The Lipitor in US is the biggest, economic sale, making bigger economic sale in US. So this is all pharma-generated thing. But as you all agree with me that we are medical students, so we do not learn medicine from Google or from these messages. So we learn medicine from books, from guidelines. So whatever the guidelines will say, we should follow that. So having said that, I'll say that CVD represents a considerable economic burden to the society, and this necessitates an effective approach for its prevention. Now, more than half of the reduction in the CV mortality in the last three decades was achieved by three population level changes in the CV risk factors. And what are those factors? One is the reduction in the cholesterol, second is the control of the blood pressure, and third is the cessation of the smoking. Also, one of the best way to live a longer life and better life is to reduce your likelihood of developing heart disease. Reduction in the cholesterol to 15 milligram per deciliter plus, if you add 5 millimeter reduction in the blood pressure, you lower the CV risk up to 50%. And so most of the CV events can be prevented by prolonged exposure to low LDL levels and systolic blood pressure. So the whole scene of statins changed in 1994 when this landmark trial called 4S trial came. So in this trial, they used simvastatin to the conventional treatment of the coronary artery disease. And the results were so remarkable, so unprecedented, that it changed the whole scenario of the treatment of coronary artery disease. So what was that? This trial showed that there's all-cause mortality reduction by 30%, the coronary events or deaths were reduced by 42% and the major adverse cardiovascular events were reduced by 34%. Then another cholesterol trialist, treatment trialist group in 2010, they gave us a rule of thumb. And that was, with each 39 milligram per deciliter reduction in the LDL from the baseline was associated with roughly 22% reduction in the MACE, regardless of the baseline LDL levels. So that is very important, you should understand that, regardless of the baseline LDL level. So that also implies that there was virtually no bottom limit for LDL lowering cholesterol. That was in 2010. So this is what we are seeing in 2019. The same thing is happening now. So this is the pyramid of the risk factors. So we are concentrating more on the primary prevention, like you have to prevent the risk factors like dyslipidemia, hypertension, diabetes, and then secondary prevention. But the baseline of the pyramid, which is the primordial preventions, we are not concentrating much on that. That starts from the childhood. If you want to treat the obesity or the high blood pressure or the dyslipidemia and the family history is there, you need to start everything from the childhood. And also the environmental factors and noise pollution is coming out to be a very big thing now, because we all are suffering from this. And this is one of the very important risk factors. Diet, again, you should concentrate from the childhood. Don't allow your children to eat whatever they want to eat and then land up with obesity, which you will never be controlled in your adult life. So these factors like diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia, and smoking, they cause endothelial dysfunction, inflammation, and oxidative stress, and collectively then they cause the CV disease. This is an old slide showing different trials, both in the primary prevention and in the secondary prevention. They proved the LDL hypothesis. And what is that? That LDL lowering is associated with reduction in the CHD events, both in the primary and the secondary trials. Although the effect in the secondary trial was much more than what we see in the primary prevention, which is demonstrated on this slide. Then in 2013, the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association combined together, they gave us guidelines on the lipid management, and they gave us four statin benefit groups, which means there are four groups where you have to give statins and they will be benefited. One was the secondary prevention. Secondary prevention is when the disease is already established. Either the patient has established coronary artery disease, has suffered from MI, or having coronary artery disease or peripheral artery disease or a stroke. So they are to be given statins. Second group was diabetes, age 40 to 75, and LDL is between 70 to 189. All these patients should be on statins. And third was the LDL level more than 190. This is basically the familial dyslipidemias. And all these patients should be on high fixed dose statin therapy to reduce the LDL level to 50 or more than 50 from the baseline. Primary prevention is the fourth group, where we have age group of 40 to 75. The LDL is same, 70 to 189. And the ASCVD risk is to be calculated in all patients when you are to start statins in primary prevention. ASCVD risk calculation is very simple. You have an app on your mobile phones, ASCVD Plus by American College of Cardiology. You have to fill few figures and it will give you the risk factor percentage. It will give you 10-year risk and then it will give you lifetime risk, both these risks. The different organizations, different associations are using different tools for evaluating the risk. There are some controversies also in that. Some people say that they underestimate, some people say they overestimate. But again, there are no Indian guidelines for this risk estimation. So by and large, we all use ASCVD Plus app to calculate the risk. But in primary prevention, if you want to start the statins, you need to talk to the patient first. you need to tell him that yes, this can be beneficial to you, what are the side effects, how this can help the patient, what are the harmful effects, everything you need to discuss with the patient, and then start the statin therapy. Then in 2018, the American College of Cardiology again, they gave us another guideline, and they gave us 10 take-home messages. One was, in all individuals, before starting any medicine, you should concentrate on lifestyle. So aggressive lifestyle. And what was more important was, and they stated that we should all start from the younger age group, in younger individuals, 20 to 39, which we never used to think. We used to start everything when we used to above 40 or maybe 50 or when we suffer from coronary artery disease. So they stressed that in younger age group we should target this and we'll start with healthy lifestyle changes. The second message was, again, this is a secondary prevention. All patients who got ASCVD should be given statins. All patients who are a high risk of ASCVD, I'll come to later, little later, what is high risk. So all these patients, the target is around 70, and they should be on the high intensity statin therapy. And if with high intensity statin therapy, the goal is not achieved, you need to add non-statin therapies. The first in line is ezetimibe, the cholesterol absorption inhibitor, and the second is the latest PCSK9 inhibitors. These are the high risk groups. Then the fourth message was, in patients with severe primary hyperdyslipidemia like LDL more than 190, again you have to give high intensity the lipid therapy, the LDL, the statins, and then again the target is around 100. If not achieved, ezetimibe, not achieved, the PCSK9. Fifth message, patients 40 to 75 years of age with diabetes, with LDL of around 70, start moderate intensity statin therapy without calculating the risk. That means almost all patients of diabetes should get these statins. So then you need to know the risk enhancing factors for diabetes. They are long duration of diabetes, albuminuria, reduced GFR, retinopathy, neuropathy. All these patients you can consider of jumping from moderate intensity to the high intensity statin therapy, again with the patient and clinician discussion. The sixth message, these are primary prevention now. So they are primary ASCVD prevention. Again, you need to discuss with the patient before starting the therapy. And seventh is, again the primary prevention, and the risk now is to be calculated. If the risk is more than 7.5% ASCVD risk, then you have to start moderate intensity therapy. But again, you have to risk enhancement factors should be studied. And what are the risk enhancement factors? They are all listed here. You can go through this, or because the time is short, I will not go into the details. These are all risk enhancing factors. But what is more important now, what we are learning more is, that is not only the LDL, you need to go a little further. So now they have come up that apoprotein B is the risk enhancing factor. If it is more than 135, this is a risk enhancing factor. And then you can calculate the C-reactive proteins more than 2 and lipoprotein A more than 50. If it is there, then it's a risk enhancing factor, it's a high risk patient. Then 9 is again the primary prevention without diabetes. LDL is around 70 to 189, and 10-year risk is from 7.5 to 20%. Again, decision depend upon the patient-clinician relationship, and then you need to discuss it. And if at all, if any case, the decision goes in against the starting of statin therapy, you should calculate the calcium score of the coronary arteries. And then if the calcium score is 0, you can stop statin, but if the calcium score is more than 100, then you will have to start statin therapy. And the 10th message was adherence to the and percentage reduction response to the LDL level should be adhered to. You have to stick to the medicine. So there are some then individuals left. They are statin benefit group. They do not come into the statin benefit group, like the patient with a less than 40 and more than 75, and the risk is less than 75. Again, you have to calculate these risk factors and then decide about the statin therapy. Now latest 2019 ESC guidelines, there are some changes, but mostly the same. But the only thing is that more we are learning about this hypothesis, we are getting more aggressive. The lipid low goal is going down. So these are the various, how do we classify the patients into various groups, like the high risk group and the moderate risk group and the low risk group. These are the various major ASCVD risk factors. They are 5 in number: age more than 45, family history, smoking, high blood pressure and low LDL, and then other high risk features: diabetes, CKD, familial clostridiomycosis, then coronary calcium, non-stenotic carotid plaque and lipoprotein more than 50, and then non-conventional risk factors again: coronary score, intima medial thickness, lipoprotein levels and metabolic syndrome. And the combination of these, they give you the various groups: the very, very high risk group, moderate risk group and low risk group. So these are the these are the latest guidelines 2019 released just 15 days back. Now they have also classified, they have given their own classification again, but what they have stressed and added in this is this, that you can, even if the patient has got coronary, CT coronary angiography done. Now CT coronary angiography is being promoted. They want, if the patient is diabetic or the high risk patient, they say if the patient is even asymptomatic, get the CT angiography done to risk stratify the patient. And if the coronary angiography shows stenosis of more than two vessels, 50% or more, then again they are classified into very high risk group. Although they are not suffering from any event yet, but still they are taken into a very high risk group. Then other groups are almost the same. But now there are Lipid Association of India also working very strong on this. And these are now 2019 guidelines. They are not, published yet. I think they are going to publish them in the CSI 2 months later. They have gone little more further. They say the Indians are at very high risk. So they not only, you see, stop at very high risk group, they have gone into extreme group. The red one shown here, these are the extreme risk groups. And they are again classified into extreme A and extreme B. Extreme B is basically a very high risk group, but in spite of getting to the goals of the LDL, the patient is getting repeated symptoms and the coronary events. So why they have classified into this? Because they have taken the LDL level to further low in these patients. So at the end, the American College and ACI, they gave us the comprehensive sort of thing. In secondary prevention, this is a flow chart that how you are to go about it. So in ASCVD, not at a very high risk group, then less aggressive treatment options than very high risk group. They are age related. The less than 75, you need to be a little more aggressive. More than 75, you need to be a little less aggressive. But then you have to give statin. But why I am saying so? Because there is again a controversy that maybe in elderly, the statins, they do not work, they have no benefit. No, this is now established that even in older age group, the statins work. And if you stop statins in the older age group, the coronary event rate increases or jumps. Then at a very high risk group, you need to be more aggressive. You need to no age specific recommendations are there, so you need to think of azithromycin and PCSK9 in these patients. While in high risk patients, you may not think of PCSK9, but in a very high risk patient, you need to think of PCSK9. This is a primary prevention flow chart, little complex, but more or less the same which I have told in the initial 10 carry home messages by the ACC and AHA. But what is more important is the risk enhancing factors. These you need to know, because these can change the picture at all. These can change the picture totally. You from primary prevention, where you think these patients, they do not need statins, but if the risk enhancing factors are there, then you may have to add the statins to these patients. Now I'll come to the general practical things which we see in our day-to-day practice. The general question is whether we should do lipid profile fasting or non-fasting. This is a very common thing, but now I think the consensus is there that fasting and non-fasting hardly makes any difference. Only the affected part is the triglycerides. they jump from 18 to 36. But at the first visit to your clinic, you can take any sample. Maybe the next visit you can ask him to come fasting. And if the triglyceride levels are more than 400, then you can take a fasting sample and see whether to start the treatment or not. So fasting sample sometimes is required only when then non-fasting TG is more than 400, then there are known hypertriglyceridemia follow-up patients, or patient is having pancreatitis and getting treatment, or you want to get some additional test which is to be done fasting, then you can get the lipid profile done. Otherwise, there is no consensus on, there is no hard and fast that you need to test it fasting. Now then, the other thing which I was discussing was, the should we stick to the conventional lipid profile or should we go beyond? So these are the recommendations of the American College of the European Society of Cardiology in 2016. So the class one was, you need to know the LDL, you need to know the HDL, you need to know the triglycerides, and then you need to know the non-HDL level, which is now getting, you see, significance, because this calculates everything except the, this calculates even the triglyceride risk also in this. So after the LDL, the next target is non-HDL cholesterol. But the things are changing now. These are the latest guidelines. Now they have added ApoB also into the class 1 category. So the ApoB should also be tested in these patients. Now what is ApoB? Or what is non-HDL first? Non-HDL is, the cholesterol is basically a fat. It cannot move freely in the blood. So you need, it need to be tagged with the lipoproteins to carry to the tissues. So there are different lipoproteins present in the blood. Chylomicrons are almost triglycerides, mostly triglycerides. Then VLDL, IDL, LAPA, LP small a and LDL, these are all lipoproteins and HDL. Now, what is non-HDL? As the name says, it is total cholesterol minus HDL. It is non-HDL. So this covers almost everything, right? So you just need to, nowadays, when you see the lipid report, mostly they have started writing non-HDL level as well. I'm done? Okay. So ApoB is basically an atherogenic substance which is attached to these lipid particles, and this is, these are atherogenic things. But what is lipoprotein attached to the HDL? It is ApoA. So that is non-atherogenic. But ApoB is an atherogenic particles. But again, now a new hypothesis is coming. Is the LDL enough, or we need to take more things into consideration, like LDL particles? Like, this is a patient where in this patient, the LDL is same, 130 in both these patients. But in this patient, the LDL particles are just 2 and apoprotein is 2. But in this patient, the LDL particles are 4 and ApoB is also 4. So this patient with more particles is at more risk than this patient with the same LDL level. So we are going beyond the LDL now. So there are some recommendations for taking when we have to take the LPA level. So LPA is to be tested in these patients. These are the guidelines they have been endorsed also by the Lipid Association of India. But now in 2019, what they want to say is that because the Indians are at a very high risk, and LPA should be tested in all patients once in the lifetime. Now LPA is a genetically driven lipoprotein. It is not affected much with the diet or something like that. So 90% of the LPA is genetically driven. It does not change. Whether you test it in the childhood or you test it in anywhere in the adulthood, it will remain same. So you can calculate once in the lifetime, and if it is more than 50, it's a very high risk patient. So you need to treat the patient in a very high risk group. Then ApoB also, there are recommendations now, the ACCH recommendation, and LPA, Lipid Association of India, has also endorsed that ApoB is likely to be the greatest value in patients with pre-diabetics, diabetics, and metabolic syndrome. And especially when the serum triglyceride levels are more than 200, these patients should be tested for ApoB. So I'll skip few slides because the time is short, and I had prepared this topic because I was told that the Arun is not coming, so I was trying to cover that portion also. Then I'll have to skip few slides. Now the LDL goal, that is the thing which is very important, and this is what has changed from 2016 to 2019. Very high risk group, the goal was 70. Now 2019, the goal is 55. High risk group, the goal was 100. Now it is 70. In moderate risk, it is 150, now it is 100, and low risk group it is 115, it is the same. So these are the latest guidelines, and the risk is, we are going down as far as levels is concerned. So this is again the same slide. So the concept now is from lower the better to lower and longer the better. So you need to, we start normally the statin therapy at the age of 40 or 50. So you don't know what is happening in the younger age group. So you need to take care of the patient in the younger age group, and longer the lipid level is kept at a lower level, better it is. So longer the better. Lipid association, as I told you, the extreme high risk group, they have recommended that the LDL level should be 35 milligrams. So they have gone down further in extreme high risk group. And this is a very important slide, the ADCI trial where PCSK9 was tested, and the acceptable range here was 15 to 25. Now doses, as you know everything about the moderate intensity, high intensity statin, but the only thing which I want to stress to you is that atorvastatin is not affected much with the renal function. So in patient of renal disorders, you can start with atorvastatin, which is a safe statin than any other statin. Pharmacotherapy, we all know that we have to start with statins with, depending upon the various high risk groups, and then if the LDL level is not achieved, then you have to add ezetimibe. If it is not achieved, then you have to add PCSK9 inhibitors. So this is the flow chart. Now, big controversies, are the statins safe? We are giving so high risk, high intensity statins, are they safe? So most of the guidelines have said yes, they are safe. Although there are some side effects, but they are very minor, the benefit is much more than these side effects. So how do you approach with the statin muscle symptoms, which is very common side effect, and you need to calculate the CKMB, if CPK, if it is less than 4 times raised, you don't need to anything, you know, to do anything. If it is more than 4 times, then you can stop statins and then restart the statins once the symptoms have settled down. Then you have to restart the statin with low dose or with the different statin. New onset diabetes. Now this is a very important thing, and this is definitely there. So it estimates that 250 patients for 4 years are on statins are needed to develop one case of diabetes mellitus. Risk is higher with more potent and higher dose of statin, that is more common in rosuvastatin than with atorvastatin, and risk is also higher in elderly. And absolute reduction in the risk of CVD is higher in higher risk patients, clearly outweighs the possible adverse effects of the small increase in the diabetes mellitus. So even if it is there, still you need to give statins to these patients. Effect on liver is safe. Now the recommendation is that you don't need to check the liver function test very often when the patient is on statin. Kidney, again, I have told you, neurocognitive functions is being discussed, that the patients, the older age group, that is why the question was in the older age group, but the consensus is that no, there is no such like thing, and this is the study which shows the no neurocognitive signals, even in the very low dose, and even the ODYSSEY trial which tested PCSK9, although the duration of the trial was 2.5 to 3 years, but in this period, they did not find any adverse event of such types. But this is important, that there is no role of coenzyme Q10 in statin-related symptoms. No role of coenzyme Q10. And the creatinine kinase and transaminase levels are not to be tested very routinely on statins. HDL, I will skip, because nowadays HDL is not a very good thing, but it is coming up very fast. It is coming up in the sense that from the quantity, we are going to the quality of the HDL. So it is not the quantity, it is not the percent, this 40 milligram or something like that, it is the quality of the HDL. So quality should be there, And these are the pleiotropic anti-atherogenic effects of the HDL. It acts through various mechanisms, and the various trials have shown that improving HDL level does not cause a decrease in the CVD outcome. Also, the American College has given that there is no limit, no target for HDL, but the HDL should be in women, in men it should be more than 48, in 48 in women and 40 in male. Triglyceridemia, very common things in our practice. Now the question is whether we should treat it or not treat it, and treat it then with what medicine. So these are the lipid guidelines. Now the target given in 2019 is the triglycerides should be less than 100. One thing we should all understand, I'm skipping all these slides, that we should all understand that the triglyceride is definitely a risk factor, definitely a risk factor. So it is definitely a risk factor for this, and we need to bring it down. Now, where are fibrates, the most commonly prescribed medicine in triglyceridemia treatment? The fibrates are almost nowhere now. And the most prescribed combination therapy is statins plus fibrates. So I think that we should avoid. And all statin-related symptoms, muscle symptoms, they are all increases. They all increase when you combine them with the fibrates. So this is nutshell about the fibrates. They increase creatinine level also, homocysteine level also, reduce GFR. So they are nowhere. So then what should be the treatment? So this is the trial, reduce it trial. Omega-3 fatty acid, this showed that if you add this to the treatment, this definitely decreases the triglyceride levels, and it has many mechanisms to control the CVD outcome. And this is now the recommended thing. These are the various trials going on, EPA, then strength trial, and then PEMA fibrate, another drug. These are the trials undergoing for this. And then the slide which I told you, from maximum tolerated dose to zetamide, PCSK9, and then now the omega-3 fatty acid, azino-pentanoic acid. But let me add to this. When I say azino-pentanoic acid or this does not mean fish oil. The fish oil capsules commercially available are not omega-3 fatty acids. They have got composition where the saturated fats are very high in that composition, very high. So it is not that, don't take that. So it is particularly this which is going to affect us. So azetamib, I have told you, the Improve It trial was the major trial which showed that azetamib definitely causes reduction in the LDL level and decreases the CVD outcome, and reaffirms the LDL hypothesis that low LDL prevents CV outcome. PCSK9s, this is a protein which is there in the liver, and what does the PCSK9 does? So there is an LDL receptor, LDL particle here. This is an LDL receptor. So LDL particle gets attached to the receptor, it goes to the cells, and then it is released again into the circulation and becomes the LDL receptor. But if the PCSK9 is there, this is the PCSK9, this also gets attached to this complex. When it goes to the cell, then the receptor also is destroyed. So what happens is the receptors are not there. Receptors are not there, so LDL is not taken out of the circulation. So when you inhibit the PCSK9, the more of the receptors are available, more of the LDL is washed, and then you have decreased LDL. And definitely, this is an now proved thing, and EvoPAC is the latest trial released, published just 10 days back, 15 days back, where they have used this avelacumab in ACS patients, acute coronary patients in the intensive coronary care unit, and they have found that the LDL level goes down very fast with this. Orion trial, this is an inclisiran, is a medicine. Now, the mechanism of action is, it does not allow even PCSK9 to be formed. It's not an inhibitor. It does not allow PCSK9 to be formed. This is the next generation. And then this is the injection again, which is to be given twice yearly, and very potent and getting very effective. So a heart failure, if there is no other indication for statin benefit, plain heart failure, especially in dilated cardiomyopathy, no role of statins, no role of statins. And in patients of aortic stenosis, again, some people say that it's a calcium and we should use statins, no role of statins in aortic stenosis. So primary prevention, calcium, I have already told. Now the next controversy is whether these statins are underprescribed or overprescribed. Yes, they are definitely underprescribed. We are not using statins in all these patients who really need it. And if we are using it, then we are not using it in a quantity, in a dose which exactly it should be done. Like this study tells us that mostly the patients are on moderate or low dose statins and not on high intensity statins. Even patients of ACS, they are not on high intensity statins. And also, it is our tendency, once the level is there, we try to decrease the statin therapy dose, which is not right. So you should stick to that dose and try to bring that LDL level if you want to give the real benefit to the patient. Can I take 5 minutes more or not? Then again, I'll take 2-3 minutes, okay. Then this is another controversy, which says that high fat diet does not increase cholesterol. Yes, it is true. Now we have learned, many studies have come which have proved that it is not the cholesterol eating which is increasing the cholesterol requirement per day is around 9 to 950 milligram percent in our body. Every function needs the cholesterol levels, cholesterol. But cholesterol level requirement in our body is around 900 milligram percent. So it is produced by two things. One is the liver, and the second, what we eat. But it is so much, you see, balanced that if you eat more cholesterol, the liver production will be less. So the balance is maintained. But if you eat less cholesterol, then the liver will have to function more. So that is what the hypothesis which they have now come up. And they say, if you take cholesterol-rich diet even, it does not affect the blood cholesterol levels. It does not affect the cholesterol level. Then again, the caloric in and caloric hypothesis which we need to follow, that is almost not there. Even a high caloric diet can be a healthy diet. Egg is another controversy which they say egg should be taken or not to be taken because it's a very high rich source of cholesterol. One egg yolk is around 200 milligram cholesterol. So the recommendations, there are little doubt about this, more research is needed, but the recommendations are you can take one egg a day, even full one egg a day. If you want to take more, then add white egg, not the full egg. And in diabetics, maybe this is also very questionable, whether we should give this or not give this. So the recommendation is, the carbohydrate in your diet should be around 40 to 50% of the total caloric requirement. And we are going down on the carbohydrate. Our diet mostly is carbohydrate. We need to go down on this. But again, there's a J-shaped curve on this. They say if you bring down the carbohydrate diet, even then the CVD risk increases. So you need to keep the balance around 40 to 50. Fats you should increase. But saturated, not the saturated fats, they should be less than 10% of the total. And even these are the diet recommendations. But even AHA, ACH, they say it should be around 5 to 6% of the total caloric requirement. Proteins you should also increase. So still there are controversies about the saturated fats, then wheat and the oil we should take. The unhealthy foods are listed here. The most, you see, important thing now is the insulin resistance. The big man is sitting here. I think he'll elaborate it more. But insulin resistance now is the culprit. Everything is happening around that. So you need to take less sugar, or maybe you should omit sugar. Sugar is the culprit. Cut down the sugar, refined sugar. Don't take that. Don't take the soft drinks which you take. One soft drink, 200 ml or 300 ml soft drink, it contains almost 25 to 30 teaspoonfuls of sugar. Never ever take that. Never ever. They are very harmful. So I think I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Due to running in late in time, we are unable to discuss the...
as a primary prevention should not be given. Dr. Bansali.
Aspirin is not for primary prevention because more risk of a cerebral bleed and hemorrhage.